And a surprise winner fights through the carnage. The USAC Silver Crown Stars sling plenty of dirt. It's a fiberglass, too. We'll have the highlights. A race for kids suffering from a deadly disease. And the Trans Am Warriors stage one to remember. We're staying up late tonight on race day. Sunday, July 7th, 1996. And good evening. Welcome to Race Day from Minneapolis. I'm Rick Benjamin. Hope you enjoyed our coverage of the Children's Grand Prix for the SCCA Trans Am Tour. We'll have more on the Trans Am event from Minneapolis coming up here in minutes. But we roll off today from Milwaukee, capping a huge NASCAR weekend. The Sears Auto Center's 250 for the Busch Grand National Stars. Mike Hogwood tells us the new asphalt at the Milwaukee Mile made for plenty of twisted sheet metal and a new face in victory lane.
Hermie Sadler, who started on the pole, was unfazed by a slippery concrete sealer laid down to help secure the new asphalt. He led early. The first of many long yellows came out on lap 26, car 72. Mike Dillon has serious damage. Also, Patty Moise and Phil Parsons with damaged sheet metal. The middle of the race belonged to Todd Bodine after putting his 81 machine out front on lap 37. In the second half of the race, a slow pit stop by Bodine allowed Dennis Setzer in car 38. And the day's biggest surprise, Buckshot Jones in the double zero to take over. Both drivers were having their best runs of the year. 65 laps left and trouble for the big contenders. Tony Stewart in car 15 goes for the low groove. He hits Sadler. Bodine is also involved and knocked out of the race. Jeff Green in car 3 also gets hit and carries on. On lap 212, Buckshot Jones still driving the race of his life and out front. But Dick Trickle, who cut his racing teeth on this track, passed the youngster from Georgia to take the lead. Seven laps later, points leader David Green brought out the 10th caution of the day. Fire coming out from underneath the car. David is okay. No one pits. Track position just too important. Four laps to go. The leaders working traffic. Jones puts pressure on Trickle. Trickle spins. No caution flag. Buckshot Jones leads, but Mike McLaughlin is coming hard. Jones holds him off and crosses the line in front by 2 feet. A great finish. It's the first Busch Grand National win for Roy Buckshot Jones. McLaughlin is second. Randy LaJoie had a strong run, finishing third. Winston Cup regular Bobby Labonte comes home fifth. The points race has tightened up. David Green's troubles has shrunk his lead over LaJoie to just 90 points. I'm Mike Hogwood reporting for Race Day.
All right, thanks a lot, Mike. We'll have more from Mike in our Charlotte studios coming up in minutes. Next up for the Busch Grand National Stars, they're going to make up a rain day. They've got a doubleheader next Friday and Saturday at Loudoun, New Hampshire. You'll see both races live here on TNN. Well, here in Minneapolis, the feature event of this Children's Grand Prix weekend, the SCCA Trans Am Stars, their ninth event of the 1996 season on a brand-new racetrack, one that provided plenty of tough competition.
Paul Genelozzi had the pole today with Cleveland winner Tommy Kendall right alongside. Three laps in, Genelozzi gets loose, and Kendall shoulders his way by for the lead. Ron Fellows started back in sixth. He made a big move up to third early on, trying to get back in the title hunt. His teammate Jamie Gallus had tire problems early in the race, but that set up another patented charge from the back for Gallus. He got up to the top 10 quickly. Halfway home, Genelozzi goes wide off turn 5. Boris Said tries to go through on the inside, but Genelozzi comes around and drills the 14 car, knocking Said from contention. Point leader Dorsey Schrader had started 5th after qualifying fastest. He got up to 2nd, but tire woes knocked him out of the chase. Scott Sharp was tough. He'd recover nicely for 3rd. Gallus hung tough for 4th. Fellows up to 2nd before catching fire after the checkered flag. And Genelozzi came back hoodless from the wreck to grab 5th. But in the end, it was all Kendall. His 2nd straight win and 3rd of the season. The victory and leading the most laps, giving Kendall the point lead 2 by 1 over Schrader. Ford also takes the lead in the manufacturer's battle by 2 markers.
Well, next up for the SCCA's Trans Am Stars, August 4th, Trois-Rivières in Canada. We'll have the highlights for you, and we'll talk to Tommy Kendall, too, in minutes today here on Race Day. Well, it was an off day today for the Winston Cup Series after Sterling Marlin took the win yesterday in the rain-shortened Pepsi 400 at Daytona. Race Day's Matt Yocum tells us tonight that power and strategy left the three major title contenders running for second best.
Rick, the 38th annual Pepsi 400 turned out to be redemption time for Sterling Marlin and the Morgan McClure team, who bounced back from a rear engine failure in February to stomp on the competition here in July. Marlin led 88 of the 117 laps completed, survived an ignition box scare and rain to score his 3rd Daytona victory in 3 years, and the 5th DIS win in 6 seasons for the Morgan McClure team.
when it came that rain, it was kind of nip and tuck on whether to pit or whether not to. And, you know, we elected to stay out because the rain was, like I said, 12 minutes away, the last word we had. And, you know, luckily enough, the rain's played in our favor today.
Marlins' dominance left the other title contenders to fight for second.
That four car is really in a class by itself, I feel like. If the 5 and the 24 and the 25 couldn't hook up and drive by them, I don't think anybody can.
There ain't no two or three cars going to pass that cat unless the ignition's out like it was there for a while. But that second ignition, they got even a better one than the first one.
Labonte and Gordon were the only two drivers to gain ground on point leader Dale Earnhardt, who now holds a slim 5-point lead over Labonte.
It's going to come down to the guy who doesn't have any problems, you know. This stretch that we're fixing to go on, if you can run all those races and not have no trouble, you'll probably come out on top.
You know, everybody that's in front of me in the points is in front of me in this race, so that's not good. But, you know, we did our part. We ran hard, led some laps, ran up front. We just ran out of time.
One final note, following the race, NASCAR impounded the Ford of Ernie Irvin, the Pontiac of Johnny Benson, and the Chevrolet of Jeff Gordon for some scheduled wind tunnel testing later this week. In Daytona, I'm Matt Yocum reporting for Race Day.
All right, thanks, man. Maybe more aero changes still to come in the second half of the season. By the way, Bruton Smith's new Texas Motor Speedway will hold a news conference this Thursday. Speculation is they'll announce that they'll have a Winston Cup race there in 1997. NASCAR won't announce next year's schedule, of course, until December. Who knows? We'll have the story for you next Sunday here on Race Day. When we come back, exclusive details on what could become a significant new racing series. We'll have that story, and the holiday weekend means plenty of wild sprint car action.
This, with NASCAR's greatest finishes and closest calls. Now you can own the most spectacular collection of history-making NASCAR moments ever assembled. To order, call 1-800-682-2222 and receive Volume 2 of NASCAR's Greatest Finishes and Closest Calls absolutely free. Order today and receive both videos for only $19.95. It's paint-swapping racing you won't find in any store. Have your credit card ready and call 1-800-682-2222 now.
Monday, NASCAR is considering creating a new truck series, which could start racing in 1998. Sources telling us the series would be for smaller pickups like the Chevy S10, the Dodge Dakota, four-cylinder engines, but Winston Cup-type chassis. Now, we've learned that two test trucks are being built at a race shop in the Charlotte area. No word on whether Japanese trucks would be legal in the new series, Nissans, Toyotas, and so forth. No announcement yet from NASCAR. We'll keep you posted right here. It's been a very big week for the world of outlaws. This
Speedway. Toby Porter in the 80 car. Out front early, he dominated the race until handing the lead to Tammy Joe Kirk with a pit stop just past the halfway mark at 100 laps. Kirk's reign at the front, short-lived though, as first Mike Cope took the lead. Then Cope forced to move over for Ron Young. Young had started 17th and patiently worked his way into contention. Once out front, there was no looking back as Young streaked to his season's third win. A persistent Porter passed Cope for second, while Tammy Joe Kirk comes away with a fifth-place finish. Well, when we come back, more from Rick Benjamin in Minneapolis, where a two-time champ took command of the Trans Am title chase today. And with the second half of the Winston Cup season about to start, who's in position to challenge for a championship? We'll size up the likely suspects next. Means it's time for the scribes and railbirds to make their assessment of who's hot and who's not. Tonight, we take a little different look at what the halfway point of this season means. Here's Matt Yocum.
1995 Winston Cup champion Jeff Gordon couldn't buy a break in February. In March, he took his first of three wins this season and has been a top five finisher 10 times in the past 13 events. Last season, Gordon was third when he used back-to-back wins at Daytona and Loudon to put a hammerlock on the Winston Cup title. Yesterday, Gordon didn't win, yet his third-place finish leaves him third in points, just 37 markers behind Earnhardt. If the Rainbow Warriors can pull their repeat in Loudon, Gordon will have reasserted himself as the man to beat in the second half of the season.
Consistency would keep us up in the top five, top ten, and maybe help boost us up there a few positions and points. So that's all we ask for. I'm content with the way we've been running, with the things that have been happening. Of course, they've been real good, but you just go with what you get. And so far here lately, we've been getting a lot of great things. And if it goes downhill from there, we just can't control it. Just keep working hard.
Making Daytona and Loudon even more important for the Winston Cup title contenders is the fact that we are in the midst of a run of 14 races in 14 straight weeks. Drivers and the men who turn the wrenches think this midsummer stretch will decide the Winston Cup title.
I think it's no doubt that the strong teams will kind of come to the top, and the ones that are struggling will sort of settle to the back, and there's no doubt that this championship, I think, will definitely be won during this next 14 races.
I think we're coming up on that stretch where there's, 14 races in a row or something. That's going to tell the story there. you know, you can't have any bad races in that stretch, you know, and if you get out there and if you can run all those races and get at them without any problems, you should be looking pretty good in the points.
The 1996 campaign has seen only six winners down from two last year at this point, plus five drivers who won in 95 hope the second half will see them get back into victory lane. In Daytona, I'm Matt Yoakum reporting for Race Day.
And you'll see all the action from Loudon next weekend live here on TNN starting at 12:30 Eastern, immediately following the early edition of Race Day. Well, just moments ago, the NHRA final were run under the lights in Topeka, Kansas. Let's take a look now at some of the pro winners. We start with pro stock, Warren Johnson against Jim Yates. It's Yates in the near lane. He leads in the points, but it's Johnson with the whole shot. A 710 ET, 194 miles an hour. And Johnson cuts into that points lead. Funny cars, John Force, near lane. Force, says the Cruz Pedregon. See ya. Wouldn't want to be ya. He's out there. He sets a new national ET record, backs up his 488 in qualifying with a 493, 303 miles an hour. That was his seventh win of the year. Top Fuel, Kenny Bernstein, near lane. Watch it. He blows up. Scott Coletta, a 466 ET. 314 miles an hour. Coletta wins Top Fuel. And our apologies to Blaine Johnson. He set a new low ET record late last night in qualifying after our report was filed. We missed it. Our hats off to Blaine and his crew. Well, it is time now for our Rogaine hair-raising finish. If you were with us earlier on TNN, you have seen it already. Last lap. Last corner in Milwaukee. Buckshot Jones with the lead and Mike McLaughlin coming hard. Look at the shot, would you? At the line, Buckshot holds on for his first Busch Series win, and that is indeed a hair-raising finish. Next on TV's fastest half hour, wild sprint car battles coast to coast. Speed Week, not just a February event. And we'll talk with today's winner of the first Children's Grand Prix in Minnesota. He's the new Trans Am point leader, too, when race day rolls on.
When you come to Western Auto and Parts America, you'll find that our guaranteed low prices on starters, alternators, carburetors, plugs, shocks, batteries, brakes...